We here at the Sports History Network proudly partner with 26 podcasts, all revolving around the history of sports. But did you know that many of our hosts were sports history authors way before they started their shows? It's true. We've got Joe Ziemba, host of When Football Was Football. Joe Zagurski, host of Pro Football in the 1970s. Mark Morthier, host of Yesterday Sports. Tommy Phillips, host of Lombardi Memories. And Scott Adamson, co-host of From the 55-Yard Line. All these authors have many books for you to choose from. To check them out, go to our website at sportshistorynetwork.com/sportshistorybooks. Pick up your copy today! Soundtrack provided by Kevin MacLeod of filmmusic.io.
What is the greatest baseball song of all time? This is a classic question of goatdom in modern sports, an unanswerable riddle which won't be solved with stats and memory, but instead is solely a matter of taste. Or so you might think. For on this episode of Truly the Goats, we have the history of and story behind what is definitely, unquestionably, objectively the greatest song about baseball ever written. What's your guess? Dozens, maybe hundreds, of top 10 listicles on the greatest baseball song ever are out there on the internet. Here's an amalgamation of the far too many such pieces I read before this episode. In no particular order, the top 10 list has a few pay-ons to superstars, like Joltin' Joe DiMaggio by Lester Brown and his orchestra.
Started baseball's famous streak that's got us all aglow. He's just a man and not a freak. Joltin' Joe DiMaggio.
Say Hey, the Willie Mays song, written by Willard
say who,
Robinson.
Say, Willie, say hey,
say who,
swinging at the plate, say hey,
say who,
say Willie, that giant kid is great.
And Dave Frischberg's surreal but alluring jazz single, Van Lingle Mungo.
Majeski, Johnny G, Eddie Juiced, Johnny Pesky, Thornton Lee. Danny Gardella, Van Lingle Mungo.
A few rarities will usually make the list, like Bob Dylan's Catfish, written for then Oakland A's lefty pitcher Jim Catfish Hunter, and later performed by Joe Cocker.
There's a stadium night.
There's Bill Lee by Warren Zevon.
Sit on your ass and nod at stupid things. Man, it's hard to do. But if you don't, they'll screw you. If you do, they'll screw you.
And Goodbye, Mr. Ball, Goodbye by that well-known musical trio of Bing Crosby, Groucho Marx, and Hank Greenberg.
Oh, goodbye, Mr. Ball, goodbye. You are gonna see an awful lot of sky. Don't hang around for Richard to open up that door when Hankus Pankus hits you where you've never been hit before.
Then there are the songs that aren't necessarily about baseball per se, i.e. Hardball by Lil Wayne.
When I'm playing hardball,
right.
So with you on the mound, about to pitch to me, understand, I'm like Griffey, I keep him to the wall.
And Bruce Springsteen's Glory Days. Finally, there are a couple of must-haves. One is Willie, Mickey, and the Duke, perhaps better known as Talkin' Baseball by Terry Cashman.
Talkin' Baseball, Klazuski, Campanella, Talkin' Baseball, the man and Bobby Feller, the scooter, the barber, and the nuke. They knew them all from Boston to Dubuque, especially Willie, Mickey, Duke.
And of course, Center Field by John Fogerty.
Oh, put me in cold. I'm ready to play.
Now that's a decent list, but none of those songs is the greatest baseball song ever. So what is? Well, the answer is after the break, but here's a hint. It's about a girl. My name is Oz Davis, and this is Truly the Goats, sports history as told through its superstars. The greatest baseball song of all time is Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Because, of course it is. Consider this. How many 110-plus-year-old songs do you know the lyrics to? How many vaudeville songs do you know the lyrics to? How many songs do the majority of Americans know the lyrics to? Or at least some of the lyrics, anyway. How many songs, never mind baseball songs, have been covered so often and inspire so many sing-alongs? And how many songs have become as ingrained into our American culture as Take Me Out to the Ball Game? Few enough to call it the GOAT of baseball songs. Take Me Out to the Ball Game was written in 1908 by Jack Norworth, the vaudeville star, who'd also write Shine on Harvest Moon that same year. It was also the year in which Christy Mathewson's New York Giants were embroiled in a season-long three-way pennant race with Honus Wagner's Pittsburgh Pirates and the Chicago Cubs, defending champs of Tinker to Evers to Chance. As the origin story goes, Norworth was riding the subway, perhaps to the Broadway area to perform later that evening, when he saw an advertisement for the Giants playing at Polo Grounds. The lyrics came to him in a flash, and right there on the subway, like Lincoln on the train to Gettysburg, he wrote out the song in nearly perfect fashion, along with a doodle or two, in 15 minutes flat. A musician named Albert von Tilzer wrote the music. The song was performed live on stage shortly thereafter, and literally within days, Take Me Out to the Ball Game, or barely disguised imitations, were being performed in other theaters by other performers. The three labels pressing records in those days, Edison Recordings, the Columbia Phonograph Company, and the Victor Talking Machine Company, all released versions of the same song. We have no reliable numbers on how many copies were sold, but we do know that 6 million copies of the sheet music were sold. That's 1 per 15 people in the entire U.S. at that time. The song, or at least part of it, was first known to be played at organized ball games in 1934. That year, Major League club owners and league presidents had adopted it as baseball's official anthem. Under that designation, Take Me Out to the Ball Game was played for Game 4 of the 1934 World Series, with the Gas House Gang St. Louis Cardinals lost 10-4 to the Detroit Tigers of Hank Greenberg, Mickey Cochran, and Charlie Gerringer. After the game, none other than Grantland Rice remarked,
"Cardinal band played Take Me Out to the Ball Game before the battle started. The way the Cardinals pitchers came and left, they should have played Take Me Out of the Ball Game."
The famous refrain of the song is one of pop music's all-time great earworms, instantly learned upon first hearing, which, if you're lucky, happens in the midst of a throng of baseball fans belting out the lyrics with gusto, if not necessarily technical artistry. But remember, Take Me Out to the Ball Game was never just a commercial jingle or an official anthem. It's a sing-along pop song, with a whole two verses beyond the 8 lines that everybody knows. Here's the entire song, as sung by Edward Meeker for Edison Recordings in 1908.
Baby Casey was baseball mad, had the fever and had it bad. Just to root for the hometown through every Sioux, Casey Blue. On a Saturday, her young beau called to see if she'd like to go to see a show. But Miss Kate said, "No, I'll tell you what you can do. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I never get back. Let me root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game." Katie Casey saw all the games, knew the players by their first name, told the umpire he was wrong all along, good and strong. When the score was just 2-2, J.P. Casey knew what to do. Just to cheer up the boys he knew, he made the gang sing this song. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I never get back. Let me root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it's one, two, three strikes, you're out at the old ball game.
Ah, Katie Casey. Singing, rooting, baseball mad Katie Casey. Why do we always sing her words but never her name? Why do we forget? Luckily, not everyone does. In an article published in the baseball history journal Baseball, that's two words, and later on MLB.com, George Boziwick, at that time chief music director for the New York Public Library for the Performing Arts at Lincoln Center, wrote, "Although this memorable chorus of Peanuts and Cracker Jack is part of our national consciousness, the song's little-known verses tell a deeper story about a woman and her desire to be part of the rooting crowd. Her name was Katie Casey, and in 1908, she was affirmably baseball's biggest fan." The name of that article was Take Me Out to the Ball Game, the story of Katie Casey and her national pastime, and George Boziwick agreed to speak on True of the Goats about his findings on his deep dive into an American historical cultural artifact, the suffragette movement of the early 20th century, and the irresistible Trixie Fraganza. What inspired you in the first place to sort of take on this research, to sort of delve into the people behind the song?
Right. Well, I'm a big baseball fan, and when I was working at the New York Public Library for the Performing Arts, everybody knew it. So the head of the exhibits at the New York Public Library for the Performing Arts came to me somewhere around in 2006, when I had just hired as chief of the music division. I worked at the library for 31 years. And the last 11 years was as chief of the music division. So I had just become chief of the music division. And she asked me, hey, you know, Take Me Out to the Ball Game is going to be 100 years old in 2008. Would you like to do a major exhibit on it? I said, oh, sure. So basically, it was an exhibit about 100 years of music, musicians, and the national pastime. So it wasn't just about the song. It was really a panorama of baseball and the performing arts. And there are just amazing things, as we all know, in these major libraries like the Library of Congress and the New York Public Library and other institutions in this country and around the world that have world-class collections. And I'm telling you, the stuff that, the New York Public Library had was just amazing, relating to baseball, music, theater, dance. And so that's what this was. This was a huge exhibit celebrating the song Take Me Out to the Ball Game. And a small portion of this was devoted to suffrage, women's rights, and that sort of stuff. And that's what really got me going. After the exhibit, I started delving into it. I presented a paper at the Baseball Hall of Fame in 2009 on Trixie Fraganza and the whole Jack Norworth thing, and how Take Me Out to the Ball Game was kind of a reluctant signifier, so to speak, for women's rights. And, you know, that's how it got started. And I compiled more and more research. And around the time that my article first came out, it came out in a scholarly journal called Baseball, A History of the Early Game. And it was edited by John Thorne, who's the official historian for Major League Baseball. And he posted it the following year in 2013 on his website. So it was around that time in 2012 that Trudy and I put together a program where we animated all this research about Katie Casey and put it on at the New York Public Library. And it just took off from there. So that's how that started.
I want to ask you this too, George. I was looking at your website, and don't you do live show or a touring show or something?
No, we do a live. We do a live show. We do a number of programs. One of them is on the song "Take Me Out to the Ball Game." The ensemble is called the Red Skies Music Ensemble, And it was founded in 2010 by Trudy Williams and myself. Trudy is the artistic director, and I'm the curator. And we take the research from Take Me Out to the Ball Game, and we've animated it into about a 90-minute program. We've given the program a couple times at the New York Public Library. Last year, we gave it at the Library of Congress. And it's a huge hit. It just animates the whole concept of Take Me Out to the Ball Game and its connections to a woman who wants to go to the game, and how that is in itself connected to the idea of suffrage and empowerment. And we presented it last year because the Library of Congress was closing out an exhibit on baseball and opening up an exhibit on suffrage. So they plunked us right in the middle between the two. It was perfect. It was really great. Yeah, it's really a great program because we cover a lot, not just Take Me Out to the Ball Game, but there were a lot of songs, dozens and dozens of songs that came out right after Take Me Out to the Ball Game. And they were all about taking your girl to a game, which suddenly became the thing to do. But the problem with the other songs is that they did not have the message of empowerment that Take Me Out to the Ball Game had. Probably the most well-known song to me, anyway, was a song called Take Your Girl to the Ball Game by George M. Cohan. And instead of a girl, a woman, going to a ball game and rooting, like Katie Casey, being really knowledgeable about the game, Cohan's song is all about taking your best girl to the game. She knows nothing about baseball. You're going to teach her all the rules of the game, and she's going to be grateful for you for the rest of her life that you introduced her to baseball. Not only that, she's going to marry you when you propose to her at the ballpark. So it's a very different kind of setup with a woman at the ballpark. And after Take Me Out to the Ball Game, Cohan's song came within days after Take Me Out to the Ball Game was introduced. And this flood of other songs, they all seem to follow Cohan's lead. A guy taking his girl to the ballpark, and she's just dependent on him, and she's baseball crazy just like he is, and that sort of stuff. There's nothing along the lines of the message that is in Take Me Out to the Ball Game. You know, you got Katie Casey, who knows all about baseball. She reads the papers, and when her boyfriend comes on a Saturday and asks her if she wants to go to a game, she says, no, take me out to the ball game. That's what you can do. And she gets to the ball game, and she goes to all the games. She knows all the players' names. She tells the umpire that his call was wrong in a good, strong voice. She knows exactly what's going on. The team is in a jam. The score is 2-2. And she knows exactly what she needs to do. She leads the boys in singing Take Me Out to the Ball Game. She becomes part of the rooting crowd. And that's the beauty of Take Me Out to the Ball Game. It's this empowerment where a woman becomes part of the crowd.
Lyrically speaking,
yeah.
For you, the important part of the song is the exhortation, is the fact that she's
right.
Saying, let's do this, right? And that's the part the greater culture remembers about the song.
Yeah, but the thing is, what the greater culture doesn't remember about the song is why we are singing Take Me Out to the Ball Game when we're already at the game.
Right.
That question is being asked constantly, you know, and we're already at the game because Katie Casey is at the game. And the first time the song was ever sung at the game was when the fictitious Katie Casey sang it in the song.
Let's talk about this. What kind of a girl, besides a baseball lover, is Katie Casey? And how would she have been viewed contemporaneously? How would she have been viewed in her time?
Well, you know, I think she would have been portrayed exactly as a lot of modern women were being portrayed at that time, around the turn of the 20th century. This was the era of the new woman.
someone who was active in the public sphere, someone who was probably employed, someone who had advantages of perhaps education. She was independent. She was perhaps athletic. You know, this is definitely what Katie Casey to me was all about. She was this new woman that was part of the early 20th century. Someone who knew what she wanted to do, was very engaged with baseball. She loved it and wanted nothing more than to be at the game. And in fact, you know, when the song says, "I don't care if I never get back," you wonder if that's a kind of suffrage association where she doesn't want to go back to the way things were. She wants to be in the ballpark, or she wants equal rights. So that's what I think Katie Casey's all about.
She doesn't want to go back to the unfair, unequal world.
Exactly.
Now, I actually first came to you, George, and I don't know, you got some good publicity for your recent work on your essay, I guess 2013, your essay, "Take Me Out to the Ball Game, the Story of Katie Casey and Our National Pastime," in which you reveal the results of your studies, which show that the inspiration for Katie Casey, our heroine, was actually a performer and comedian named Trixie Fraganza. Tell us about Trixie Fraganza.
Well, her real name was Delia O'Callaghan, and Trixie Fraganza was a real vaudeville star. She was also an active suffragist. You should Google her and get a picture of her. Do a search online and get a picture of her, because when you see the programs that are being aired this year, the 100th anniversary of the suffrage movement, her image pops up really frequently. She was very active as a suffragist. She gave speeches all the time. She was even acknowledged by her employers, George M. Cohan and Sam Harris. She was starring in a play in 1908 called The American Idea. And the producers of the play, Cohan and Harris, expressed in the paper their support for Fraganza being an active suffragist. And that's pretty cool, you know, an active suffragist. And she and Norworth came into contact in Chicago in 1906. And let's just say that Norworth was infatuated with her. You know, that seems to be what was reported in the papers. It's very difficult to find information about this affair that was in the papers. But
yes, I experienced that.
It did come to a head in the fall of 1907. When there were newspaper articles to the effect that Norworth's wife, Louise Dresser, who herself was a very famous actress, she was saying that Norworth is seeking a divorce from her so that he and Trixie Fraganza could marry. So fast forward a couple of months to May 2nd, 1908. That's the day that "Take Me Out to the Ball Game" was registered for copyright. And that was right in the middle of what would have been their affair. So it stands to reason that there's a good possibility that the independent woman that's portrayed in the verses of Jack Norworth's lyrics of the song certainly point to Trixie Fraganza. So you've got that. You've got the copyright of May 2nd, when they would have been in the middle of this affair. And there are at least 30 known covers to the first edition of "Take Me Out to the Ball Game," and Trixie Fraganza is on two of them. So that, to me, is some evidence. We don't know for sure, but there are pointers to the fact that Norworth's song may have been influenced by his affair with Trixie Fraganza, the character Katie Casey.
The presence of women at the ballpark in 1908 was not new, but it was still considered unusual. The increase in female attendance altered the informal, exclusive social club atmosphere and elicited considerable resentment from many men. Despite this, ball club owners eagerly exploited the idea of women at games, as it was commonly thought that the presence purified the game's nastier elements and would increase attendance by men who simply wanted an opportunity to be where women were. "Take Me Out to the Ball Game" certainly promoted the idea of women attending games, The song was indeed infectious, and you could get every word, but while the public may have been receptive to that idea in a song, in reality, getting every word would take some time, from George Boswick's essay. Just to get a bit speculative for a minute, it is said that Jack Norwood didn't see his first ball game until, you know, 20, 30 years after he wrote Take Me Out to the Ball Game. He probably saw Babe Ruth, actually, if he did. Why would it be important for that setting and this girl in this song? Why a ball game?
Because Norwood said it himself. I was looking for a new song for my act, and why not a baseball song? So you have to remember that he told this story 50 years after the song was written. He told the story that he was riding a subway train and he saw a sign that said, "Ball game today, Polo Grounds." And he said, "I needed a song for my act at the Amphion Theater that night. And so why not a baseball song? It sounded like a good idea." So that's what he did. He created a song about a woman who loves baseball and wants nothing more than to go to the game.
As somebody who really understands music like you do, what is it about this song? I mean, this song has been kept alive now, like viable, like people know this song for over 110 years now. What's the secret? Is there a chord structure? Is there a harmony going on? What's going on with the song?
Well, that's a really interesting question, and I would say yes to all of that. And first of all, you know, unlike our beautiful national anthem, which is a wonderful anthem, Take Me Out to the Ball Game is easy to sing, and everybody knows it, and everybody can sing it. And it's a beautiful waltz, three-quarter time, and it sort of embodies the democracy of the ballpark, where everybody can come together to be part of the rooting crowd. Everyone wants to be part of that rooting crowd and participate in the national pastime to root for the home team. And these ideas of participation at the ballpark, singing the song together with the crowd, with the rooting crowd, these rituals are passed down from generation to generation, you know? So it's very important, and it's not surprising then that Happy Birthday, the Star Spangled Banner, and Take Me Out to the Ball Game are the three most performed songs.
Right.
And why not? You know, the Star Spangled Banner is performed at the beginning of every game. It's very important, and as is Take Me Out to the Ball Game. It's a part of us all coming together.
What sparked the idea for this podcast was, I saw yet another article, the top 10 baseball songs of all time, top 20 baseball songs of all time. There are dozens, maybe 100 of these things online, and not one of them has this song, Take Me Out to the Ball Game, in it. Now, I know it's 110 years old, so people want to call it a classic, but it was a pop song.
Yeah.
How come people don't think about it like that anymore?
I just think that its associations with the game are just so strong. I think people just take it for granted, you know, which is not such a good thing. But you mean to tell me that this is not listed in the top 10, top 20 baseball songs?
Yeah. Yeah.
Aside from Center Field, you know, by John Fogerty, what's considered a great baseball song? I can tell you what I think are great baseball songs.
Well, it's usually stuff like Talking Baseball's on there, Say Hey, the Say Hey Willie Mays song. Jolt and Joe DiMaggio is on there. Yeah. One of my personal favorites is Goodbye, Mr. Ball, Goodbye, which is Bing Crosby, Groucho Marx, and Hank Greenberg. But nobody knows this song anymore.
Wow, I don't know that one. Oh, that's a good one. One of my favorites that we do in our Red Skies Music Ensemble programs is Gee, It's a Wonderful Game.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Ring Lardner co-authored that. It's such a wonderful song. Really great.
I don't know. 'Twas Christy Columbus is what they tell me. Maybe so. I don't know. There's only one Christy that I know at all. One Christy that pitches for Muggsy McGraw.
I've got one more question for you, real quick. Okay, I don't know if you can help me out with this, but is Katie Casey related to Mighty Casey?
No. No. I can point to Frank DeFord. He used to be on National Public Radio. I think he's written something along those lines. And they are not related.
Excellent. All right. Well, I thank you for the definitive answer on that.
Sure.
Okay. George Boziwick, thank you very much for coming on to Truly the Goats this time. Thanks for all your excellent work. Where can people find some of your stuff, maybe stuff about your live show and whatnot?
You can go to georgeboziwick.com. Or you can go to the Red Skies Music Ensemble.com. Either one will take you to the page where you can locate some of the programs we've done. We've not only done programs on Take Me Out to the Ball Game, we've also done programs on Emily Dickinson and music. And I am in the midst of writing a book on Emily Dickinson and music. And maybe that's for another show, but when she was younger, she was quite the musician and collected a lot of sheet music. And that sheet music is in the Dickinson collection of the Houghton Library at Harvard. And so I'm writing a book on all the music that she collected and the significance of the music that she knew and heard and the concerts she saw and things like that. So we do a program, several programs on Emily Dickinson, and have presented at major organizations around the place. And so that's it.
Thanks very much, George.
You're very welcome.
From George Boswick's essay. When you can get away to the carefree atmosphere of the ballpark, the experience of singing Take Me Out to the Ball Game during the seventh inning stretch creates a magic of participation and belonging as memorable as the ball game itself. Jack Norwood's sensational baseball song unites players and fans, young and old, male and female, who still seek that common bond and restless urge, like generations before them and the fictional Katie Casey, to be part of the rooting crowd. Knowing what we now know about Take Me Out to the Ball Game, imagine that tangible moment that Katie Casey must have felt back in 1908, walking into the ballpark for the first time, taking in the atmosphere and thinking to herself, I don't care if I never get back. This has been the Truly the Goat Sports History Podcast, an Inclusive Medium production. Visit us online at trulythegoats.com and on Facebook and Twitter at Truly the Goats. Truly the Goats is also a member of the Sports History Network. Check out sportshistorynetwork.com, headquarters of sports yesteryear, for more like-minded podcasts. Music used in this episode of Truly the Goats includes Edward Meeker's version of Take Me Out to the Ball Game for Edison Recordings, which is in the public domain. Lyrics and song are available at trulythegoats.com/takemeout. Our theme song is Fun on Street, Greatest Remix of All Time, and is produced by David Liso of Dynamo Stairs. Truly the Goats would like to thank Peter Boziwick for joining this episode. George's essay, Take Me Out to the Ball Game, The Story of Katie Casey and Our National Pastime, is still available online through mlblogs.com or direct link through tinyurl.com/KatieCasey. This is Oz Davis for Truly the Goats and Inclusive Media. Thanks for listening. Stay healthy out there. And remember Katie Casey. Yeah.
At the Sports History Network, we're all about sports yesteryear, and so we're so pleased to introduce you to Row One, an online memorabilia gallery and shop that brings your sports history to life anywhere. The Row One gallery includes over 5,200 gorgeously reproduced prints of team posters, game program covers, game tickets, advertisements, and more in baseball, pro and college football, pro and college basketball, and more. And any gallery item may be printed in a variety of sizes on wood, metal, canvas, acrylic, or poster paper. And in Row One shop, check out the thousands more of unique items with a retro and historical designs dating back to 1876, including t-shirts, long sleeve shirts, phone cases, mugs, blankets, pillows, towels, and even shower curtains. Go to sportshistorynetwork.com, ROW number one, for access to the full Row One catalog and for gallery prints and gift items. Plus, get a 15% discount off all prints on the Row One Pictorum Gallery with coupon code SHN15. Follow the link on the show notes.